Okay, welcome to this session on automating data processing and analysis in ArcGIS. You'll have seen from John's presentation and some of the presentations this morning the importance of geospatial analysis. And we know that ArcGIS is a fantastic platform for carrying out analysis with spatial data. There are hundreds of tools in ArcGIS Pro, for example, and if you include all the extensions, it's perhaps 1,500 geoprocessing or analysis tools in ArcGIS, and all of those tools are available through the user interface of ArcGIS Pro, through some of the web interfaces as interactive analysis tools that you can use for simple processes like loading data, all the way through to complex analysis like running machine learning models to extract buildings from aerial imagery. But there's also a lot of capabilities within ArcGIS for automating those workflows, for chaining those together. And that's really what we're going to focus on in this session today. So we're going to look at a few areas and take a deep dive into those. Now, why would you want to automate those processes? Well, if you're like me, it's going to make fairly lazy. It's going to make your life much easier. It's going to simplify a lot of things. But there are some very specific reasons why you might want to automate geoprocessing workflows. If you've got complex, multi-step tasks, automating them will make them much simpler. You can narrow them down to a single step, a single script, or a single tool. If you've got workflows that you need to repeat, you want the same results every time with new data, for example, you can make those workflows repeatable by automating them. If you've got workflows that you need to share across your organization, you need to collaborate with others, you need to document them, automating them provides a really great way to do that. If you've got workflows that you need to run regularly, once a day, once an hour, once a month, once a year, by automating them, you can schedule those and have those run repeatedly. And in fact, you can have them run out of hours so that you can run them overnight, for example, for updating data sets. So in this session, we don't have time to cover all the different automation areas of ArcGIS. You saw some of them in the plenary earlier around velocity and raster analytics. We're going to take a dive into working with ArcGIS Pro, looking at models, using Python and Jupyter Notebooks, and then using them within ArcGIS Online and scheduling them. And finally, at the end, we're going to take a sneak peek at some new capability allowing you to take ArcGIS workflows and implement them in big data platforms such as Apache Spark. But to start, I'm going to hand over to Arthur, who's going to take you through some capabilities of ArcGIS Pro.
So hello, everyone. I'm going to start by talking about ModelBuilder. So ModelBuilder is a feature of ArcGIS Pro that allows for code-free visual automation of various different types of workflows. The way it works is you can simply drag and drop your geoprocessing tools to create diagrams like this, and that allows you to execute multiple different tools with a single button press. So to demonstrate, I'm going to show you maybe a slightly unusual workflow, but one I think highlights the benefits quite nicely. So here I've captured some 3D scan data at the front of our Aylesbury offices. And what I want to do with this data is I want to convert it into a 2D coverage map that shows which areas of my site are covered by the 3D scan data without having to load in the entire data set. And to do that, I'm simply just going to follow the steps in this ArcGIS documentation. But I'm going to convert that into a model so that I can automate the process. So moving over to ArcGIS Pro, you can see I've got a couple of LAS files, and these are what contain my scan data. And both of these just represent different parts of the same site. And I want to combine both of these together into a single output 2D coverage map. And so both of these are just in a single folder just called Site 1. So to automate the process, I've created a model using ModelBuilder. And before I dive in depth, I'm simply just going to run this model. So I see it in my toolbox in my project. I can simply open it up. And once this is loaded, I can run it. And so this is now running this entire model in the background. So what this model is doing, to begin with, we're bringing in a folder containing our input data, in this case, just the Site 1 folder. We're then running it through this tool called Iterate LAS Files. And what this actually is another model. So I've nested a model builder model inside another one. And if we have a look at that model, we can see what it's doing. It's using an iterator to find all of the LAS files within that input folder, and it's outputting that as a list. It's also then running a separate tool to find the name of our input folder. You can see both the folder name and the list of files within that folder have the little P next to them, and that means that they're parameters. And so when we bring this model back into our other one, you can see that those are being brought through so we can continue processing with them. So we're then taking our list of LAS files and we're converting them into an LAS data set, and this simply combines them together into one object so we can continue processing. Once we've done that, we can then start running through all of the different steps. You can see it's quite a long processing chain here. We're going through multiple different tools. And these are simply just following the steps of that workflow guide I found. And so to create this model, all I did was simply follow the documentation guide and ran through all of the steps one by one individually. And that's these first six tools just here. And all I did was once I'd run them through and checked that it all worked, I could simply drag and drop from my history here directly into the model, and all of the parameters are carried over. So I didn't have to set anything additional up. And you can see running it through it manually, it took about 3 minutes from start to finish, going through each tool. And you can see the model that I started running a minute ago has just finished. It took only 48 seconds. So that's a considerable time saving already by automating the process. Now imagine if we had multiple scans that we had to process, that would be a huge time saving. We're then combining it with a few other statistics, and then we're saving the output here. And you can see, again, I've marked the output as a parameter, and that means I can define the name. If I double-click on this, you can see that the name is a little bit unusual. We're using a name called percent folder name percent. And what this is doing is it's actually referencing this folder name parameter from earlier on in our model. And so you can see our output has been dynamically named site1 underscore coverage. And if we go out to our map, you can see that it's worked correctly and brought in both of our scans. So that's a quick overview of ModelBuilder. And the ModelBuilder offers quite a lot of functionality to allow you to automate your different workflows. But sometimes you might want to go a little bit further, and that's where Python comes in. So Python is a programming language that has various characteristics that make it very suitable for use in automating workflows. So to start with, it's both modular and extendable. And this means that you can customize the functionality for your specific needs. It's also open source and easy to learn. What this means is a big community of other Python users out there that can help you and provide code snippets and things for you to use in your own projects. And once you get good at Python, it becomes very efficient to use. And sometimes it's quicker to write a quick Python script to do what you need than it is to sort through a bunch of menus. So within ArcGIS, there's two ways that we can integrate with Python. The first of these is ArcPy. And this is a way of accessing the geoprocessing capabilities of ArcGIS within Python scripts. And this allows for similar functionality to what I was showing with ModelBuilder a little bit earlier. It's just that now we can script it using Python. And then the ArcGIS API for Python is another way of integrating. And this is for automating your ArcGIS portal, whether that's ArcGIS Online or Enterprise. And this means that you can automate the entire process of creating content within your portal and sharing it with users and even administering users and adding new members to your organization, for example, all within Python scripts. Now, both of these functions can be accessed within standard Python scripts, but I think the better way of using Python with ArcGIS is through ArcGIS Notebooks. So ArcGIS Notebooks are built on the foundation of Jupyter Notebooks, which are an open standard for sharing computational documents. And this simply refers to documents that contain formatted text and other media alongside interactive blocks of code. And these allow your users to view your workflows and also interact with the code blocks to change parameters and see the outputs change in real time. So within ArcGIS Notebooks, you can author and run these notebooks within a desktop environment with ArcGIS Pro, within a cloud environment with ArcGIS Online, or using your on-site hardware in ArcGIS Enterprise. And this allows you to share workflows and analysis across your organization in the same way you would with any other content item within ArcGIS. And that you can also embed interactive maps and content directly within your notebooks. And this means that users aren't having to constantly switch applications or tabs. Everything can be self-contained. So I'm just going to demonstrate notebooks, again, using ArcGIS Pro here. And I'm going to do a bit of data wrangling. So I've written a quick notebook here. And what this does is it brings in some scientific data about the rates of change of glaciers over the last 20 years. And if you're paying attention during the closing plenary, you might see the output of this notebook pop up on some of the slides. So if you have a look at our source data here, essentially, I've got a few folders. And these contain a whole load of CSV files that contain our data. Then we've got another folder of some different CSV files containing different data. And what we want to do is combine the data for the relevant region together so that we can map it in ArcGIS. And that's what this notebook does. So to start with, we start as we would with any other Python script. We import some libraries. And these are libraries that are included with your ArcGIS Pro installation. So there's no need to set anything up to get started. We can then define a few functions. So these simply import the data that we need from our CSV files, and they import them as a standard Python data format. We're then bringing in the GeoAccessor module from the ArcGIS API for Python. And what this does is it uses the coordinate data from within our source data set to extend that default Python data format into one that's got some extra ArcGIS functionality. And what this allows us to do is, for example, export that data directly back into an ArcGIS feature class. So once we've defined all of our functions, we can then set some parameters. Here I'm just setting the path to our input folder, and also a file geodatabase where we'll store our outputs. And then we can actually run the script. And so here, all this is doing is it's looping over all of these CSV files in our input folder. And it's simply running those functions that we defined earlier to create what's called a spatial data frame, and then export that back into our geodatabase. I'm not going to run this here because it takes a little while. What I am going to show you, though, is some of the code blocks that I use to test those functions. So one of the benefits of working with notebooks is that you can run cells individually. So for example, I can run just this cell. And because I've run everything beforehand, I'm simply just calling the function that I defined earlier. And here you can see it's generated an output very quickly. And here we're bringing in just the data, the first few lines of the data from region 8 from this CSV file. And again, because we're in notebooks, we can simply just change the value here and rerun just this code cell. And it won't have to rerun the entire rest of the script. We can just see the output generate. And now, because this is a nice ArcGIS Jupyter notebook, we can then plot this on a map. And here, we haven't written anything to disk. We're still working dynamically within our notebook. You can see we're able to insert an interactive map with our data on it. We can even click on a point and see the data in a pop-up. We can then export this out. So here, if I just run this cell, this is simply running the export function that I wrote earlier, and you can see it's been added to our map. So if I go over to our map, you should be able to see the output data has been added. That's over here. But yeah, anyway, that was a quick overview of notebooks in ArcGIS Pro. I'm now going to hand back to Dom, who's going to talk more about the use in ArcGIS Online.
OK, so as Arthur mentioned, notebooks can be authored in ArcGIS Pro. You can also author them and run them in ArcGIS Enterprise with notebooks, ArcGIS Notebook Server, and also ArcGIS Online as a software as a service. I'm here in ArcGIS Online with the notebooks that I have access to. And like everything else in ArcGIS Online, a notebook is represented as an item in the system, which means I can share it with my colleagues. I can share it across my organization so that others can access and run that notebook if they want to. So it's a great way of documenting processes that you want to run across the organization. So I'm just going to go into a notebook that I have here. And this is a notebook that we've used in our content team for generating a pavement width database based on Ordnance Survey master map by downloading the data regularly and rerunning that process. I just want to pull out a few things in that notebook, the first of which is one of the things I'm doing at the top of this notebook is importing the ArcPy library. So that means within ArcGIS Online, not only do I have access to the geoprocessing tools through the user interface, I also have access to all of the geoprocessing tools that are available, for example, in ArcGIS Pro through the ArcPy Python library. And I can use all of those within ArcGIS Online without having to install anything locally or without having to have ArcGIS Pro installed. So it's an incredibly powerful tool for analysis inside of ArcGIS Online. The other thing I wanted to show about notebooks is we can not only run them interactively. If I go to the tasks menu for my notebook, I'm able to create scheduled tasks for notebooks that are in ArcGIS Online. So if I wanted to create a new scheduled task, let's create one here. I set up this task. I can decide when I want it to start. I can decide how often I want the notebook to run. So in this case, I want to run it once a week as the master map data at Ordnance Survey is updated. I choose the day, I choose the time I want it to run, and how long I want it to run for. And once I've done that, I create a new task inside ArcGIS Online. And then that notebook will run automatically on a schedule without any user interaction. So we've talked a lot about how to automate workflows within the ArcGIS system. But many organizations are building analytical data platforms, making use of cloud-based big data technologies such as Apache Spark and Databricks. And so something that we're releasing later this year to help support those workflows and to bring the ArcGIS geoprocessing capability into those platforms is something called ArcGIS Geoanalytics Engine. So this will allow organizations to take those geoprocessing tools and deploy them into their Spark clusters, which allows you to scale your geoprocessing across large clusters with many cores to really speed up processing of big data. We're releasing this later in the year. It's going to include 120 or so spatial functions, and it's going to add spatial types to those big data platforms. And we're supporting all the big cloud platforms such as AWS, Azure, and Google, as well as Databricks. And then later on, we'll be supporting some on-premise options as well. So this is a new product. I'm just going to give you a very quick preview of what that looks like. So if I go back to my web browser, and this time I'm not using a Jupyter Notebook or ArcGIS Notebooks. I'm connected to a Databricks Notebook running in Microsoft Azure. And I've got a large cluster, or actually it's a relatively small cluster. It's about 40 CPUs. And I'm going to do some very quick spatial analysis using that compute cluster. So I'm using a Databricks Notebook, which is a Python notebook. And the first thing we want to do is import the new geoanalytics library into our compute cluster, which I've done. So that's now available across all of the cluster. And the next thing I want to do is bring in some data. And I'm using some open crime data. There's about 40 million records in this data set. And I'm just bringing that into the system. And we can see that it's got some information about the crime type and the location, the longitude and latitude. And I want to do some spatial analysis on that data. So the first thing I need to do is add a spatial type to that data. So I'm going to take the latitude and longitude data, and I'm going to create a point out of that and reproject it into British National Grid so that I can do my analysis locally. So I'll just run that across the data. And you'll see what that's done is it's added a geometry column, which allows us to then carry out the spatial analysis. So I'll finish off with running this spatial analysis. I'll just start the job now. And this is taking those 40 million points. I'm using a hex bin functionality, which was going to take those points and aggregate them into small hexagon polygons so I can see the density of crimes in different areas. And you can see that took about 10 seconds to run across that very large data set. And then finally, we can plot those as a result using one of the widgets in the data in the map, and we can see the density of crimes across those polygons. So that's just a very quick example of taking quite a large data set and processing that on a big data cluster using Apache Spark. OK, so I'm glad you all got some coffee at the break, because that was a very quick run through of some of the ways of automating ArcGIS. And you can see that it's an incredibly powerful capability within ArcGIS. You can automate kind of individual processes. You can also do scheduling. You can also use it to integrate with other platforms, such as Apache Spark. There's going to be some more sessions. There's some in here later on today, one on velocity and one on integrating with Microsoft applications using Power Automate. So there's lots of other capabilities within ArcGIS. So I guess I'll finish this session by asking you to think about how can you optimize the workflows that you have in your organizations by using some of the different automation capabilities within ArcGIS. Thank you.